This is basically to the parents, and we're supposed to talk to parents. I think it's the same idea, same talk. If we need to bring our young boys and girls as good Muslims, we need to think of what Allah has given us as parents. In fact, it's a blessing. And there is a challenge. First, having children is a blessing. And children are the ornaments of life. Zinatul hayat al-dunya. They are the ornaments, the beauty of life Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. So we can enjoy it. Assume someone is deprived of having children. What do you think when they enter the house? They feel like entering a graveyard, right? No good sounds, you know. Sounds of children shouting, maybe quarreling in the house, is a beautiful sound that some people are missing. So it's a blessing to have this, but the most important blessing is to raise them as good Muslims so that you can get the hasanat out of their raising. And the most important thing is they will make dua for you even after you depart and leave this life. As the Prophet ﷺ said, كُلُّ ابْنِ آدَمْ إِذَا مَاتَ ابْنُ آدَمْ انْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ. When the children or the son of Adam dies, all of his deeds cease. So there is no more gaining of deeds because his life is over. Except three things. صَدَقَةِ الْجَارِيَةِ, a running charity that he left behind. He left a good project. He left some charity that is running a house for orphans, or he dug a well, or he built a masjid, or something of that sort. Anything that is good for the Muslim community, that's a running charity. وَعِلْمٍ يُنْتَفَعُ بِهِ. He left behind some knowledge, either in writing, in sayings, anything that people would benefit from, out of ilm, a good knowledge of the deen, then obviously even things attached to the deen, which is of benefit to the Muslims, obviously is going to be part of the work that is running behind a mad person. Well, he's getting hasanat, although he's inside his grave. And وَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدُعُ. If you leave behind a righteous son or daughter, they will make dua for you. And that means Allah will answer their dua. But they have to be righteous. They have to be good. How can they be good? If you make them so, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to work hard at making these children of ours righteous, very, mashallah, straight on the path of Islam, well, first in the matters of religion. Because, let me tell you, when I talk about knowledge and ilm, I don't mean that we need to have the full knowledge and everyone becomes a scholar. That's not the point. And I can direct you to a very good book written by two scholars, Sheikh Abdullah Muslim and Sheikh Salah. What is his last name? Salah. I forgot his last name. But it's called مَا لَا يَسَعُ مُسْلِمَ جَعْلُهُ. I hope it's translated into English. It's found an Arabic, it's over the internet free of charge. You can find it. Called مَا لَا يَسَعُ مُسْلِمَ جَهْلُهُ. A knowledge that a Muslim cannot stay without. It's not possible for any Muslim not to know this knowledge. And obviously, this includes faith and learning the principles of faith and iman, and learning how to do salah, learning how to do zakah, and siyam, and hajj, and halal, and haram. All the basic elements of the deen have to be understood by every Muslim. That's what we need to give to our children. They can practice afterwards, there's no problem in that. But then, they have to go into something different in their life, they can go. But they have to have a knowledge, a good knowledge of whatever they do in life. Meaning, if a person is in the area of finance, he has to know what Islam says about finance. Otherwise, how can you conduct yourself in the banking business, in the finance business, and specialty, when you do not know what Islam says in this regard? If you're in the business of raising animals or slaughtering animals and all this area, then you have to know what Islam, what the Islamic rules are in this regard, and so on and so forth. And it applies to every facet of life. We need to know what Islam says in order for us to be safe and to worship Allah, not only through the very major worships of Salah, Zakat, Siyam, and so on, but even with this and not transgressing the boundaries set for us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very, very important. So, as parents, children are blessings. They can give you joy in this life. They can add life to your life. They can be a source of help and support. And we can see it. Alhamdulillah, many, especially in the business area, many people would like to have many sons and daughters, especially sons, so they can go and manage their own affairs and keep the tradition going. And mashallah, enjoy the sons and the daughters found in the house and throughout the family, even if they grow up and have their own separate places, even with you in the same place or same country or go to another country, you still have that mashallah feeling that I have a family, I have an extended family, I have people who are in this place or that country or this country. It's a blessing. But even the most important blessing is not that you need them when you grow old and you need their help and support, inshallah, if they are good Muslims and they obey their parents, they are kind to them, obviously they'll come back to you and they'll help you when you need them. But then, the most important thing is how you raise them according to the Islamic rules. It's a challenge, especially young people. I know some parents have failed to grow their children right. Why? It's either because they're so soft or so harsh. And neither way is good. Remember yesterday we talked about moderation and wasatiyya and i'tidal. Same thing applies to the upbringing and education and discipline of children. Wallah, I remember some good parents out of their own love of children, when they don't wake up for salah, they drop them from upstairs on the stairs all the way to downstairs and take go to masjid. You cannot do this. You're a person, you don't go to masjid. You see, now the children are doing something else than everything else but the salah. Because you know you cannot force it this way. Look at the Prophet, even when he's the Prophet and he is the leader of the Muslim community, yet he never hit anyone, even with this, with siwak. Anas radiallahu anhu, the servant of the Prophet, who came to him, actually, his mother came to him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm giving Anas to you to serve you and to learn from you. He didn't ask for a servant. His mother brought him to the Prophet. And even when Anas, he said, I served the Prophet 10 years. He never said to anything that I did, why you did it. And he never said to anything I did not do, why you did not do it. He was training him, disciplining him by example. This is like teaching, educating by example, not necessarily by words. Yes, They need words from time to time. They need education. But they see. Children are smart, by the way. And they watch everything. See, you can see small children when you pray in the house. They do like you, right? They even stand up and they even bring something to pray, a mat or something, and they pray like you pray. If they see you, make the spirit. If you shout at their mother, they will shout at their brother. And this is, there's a famous saying in America that the father comes home tired from work, he shouts at his wife. The wife cannot shout back to him. She shouts at the boys, and the boys cannot shout to the mother. So they shout at the dog. It's just like this. Whatever you put in, you get out. Okay? So that's a problem, because we tend to react in the same way that people act towards us. And if we act positively towards our children, they will act back in the same way. If we're humble, if we're soft, if we're kind, if we're generous, if we're forgiving, the children will become like that. If the other way around, they'll become like that. And obviously, it's what they have been trained to do in life that they will get. So we need to watch this and be in the middle. Not be so lenient towards our children. Let them do whatever they like. They have to be a discipline. And discipline is important. SubhanAllah, some people let them sleep whenever they want, wake up whenever they want, do whatever they want. They can play to any time of the day and the night as they like. That's chaos. That's disorder. That's not discipline. But in the meantime, they're so strict that they say, you don't need to play, okay? You have to study. You have to read the Quran. You have to pray. You have to do this. No. Tell them you have a time to go to bed. You have a time to wake up. You have a time to read Quran. You have a time to go to Salah. You have a time to play. And provide play for them. Because some people make everything possible for the adults and they forget about children. They have, mashallah, nice salon or an area of reception for the guests. They have nice bedrooms, but they don't have a place for children to play. Even if you assign one room, if possible, for them to enjoy, take them to playgrounds. Let them practice this. Let them enjoy, because children need this time. They need to learn from playing. If you can make it, as they call it, edutainment, education and entertainment at the same time, that would be even better. Because you're teaching them through entertainment, through playing, which is important. You know, all these factors have to be there. We need to make sure that we give the children the opportunity to grow in a balanced way. And if they like something, they will even spend more time in it. They may forget about that. You know, it's power, it's a gift from Allah that some children would like to be scholars, to be good students. Some of them don't like to play so much like other boys and girls. MashaAllah. You know, even they don't. And Imam Malik, the great imams, they used not to spend so much time in play. They always aspire to be big leaders. They aspire to grow up fast and quick. MashaAllah. That's the way to do it. Is you need to give them the opportunity and help them, just like you take care of a small plant. See, when you want a good, healthy plant, you first prepare the ground for it, and you water it, you protect it, don't expose it to the outside factors, and then it will grow. And it will grow, of course, you need to cut some branches here and there until the tree becomes healthy and strong and big, and then that's it. It's a full-grown tree. And the same thing for a child. We need to take care of them, provide them emotional satisfaction. Very, very important. You see, when Al-Aqa ibn Habis came to the Prophet and he saw him kissing Al-Hasan and Hussein, holding them, kissing them, he said, "You do that, O Messenger of Allah." He came from the desert. And he said, "I have 10 children. I never kissed any of them." He said, "What should I do when Allah takes mercy out of your heart?" It's this out of mercy, this is importance of this emotional satisfaction is very, very important. If you don't give it to a child, they will look for it outside. They'll go to peers, they'll go to people who will be so affectionate, so soft, and they will come and hold them and bring them closer, and then they may abuse them. See? So it's important. But some people overdo it until they spoil a child. It will become a child with no manners. So the balance is important. We have to balance things out. Give them everything they need emotional support, they need direction, they need guidance, they need discipline. Sometimes, yes, if they do something wrong, you have to warn them, and warn them again, warn them sometimes. You may even punish them, as in the hadith, see the direction of the Prophet is that you ask your child to pray, just only ask them to pray. Don't force them, don't punish them if they don't do it, until they reach 7 years of age. But then, when they reach the age of 10, so start asking them to do it from at the age of 7. Before that, they can see it, they can see you, they can imitate, act like you, and so on. But then between 7 and 10, when they reach the age of 10, and they don't do the salah, then there must be something wrong there. So you can strike them. How do you strike them? Bring a big stick like this and try to say, "I'm going to punish you." It's not the idea. Even striking is just a very light thing, only to show them that you're not happy. It's not a sort of hitting or striking is not an end in itself. It's only a means. And very many parents do not know the difference. Sometimes we retaliate for ourselves because he didn't obey me, he didn't listen to me. I'm striking him. Wrong. You're doing it because you want to discipline this boy or this girl in a soft way, only to show them that they have gone away from the track and you can bring them back. And not every time. Not every time you're supposed to do that. Only do it from time to time if they need to. But sometimes a good word, sometimes just a look can do it. Some good parents, mashallah, a way of just looking at a child. Hey, stay there. So that's good enough for a child to understand that they were doing something wrong. And teaching is important. Take them, spend some time with them. I know that there are parents who didn't have much time for their children. Which is really a big challenge. Yes, you work for their own benefit. You earn for them. You work hard in order for you to gain some wealth and spend on them and make their life better. Yes, we can understand that. However, don't make this at the expense of their own time. You have to spend time on them. There are parents who go out to work when the children are still asleep. They come back from work when the children are asleep. So they never meet them. and will stay like for days and days. Why is that so? Because you say, well, I'm early for them. I need to make their life better. I need to make them happy and satisfied and give them enough income and so on. Well, first, you have to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought rizq for everyone. And you are only a means. It's not your hands, it's the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the first thing. Secondly, they don't need your money only, they need your wealth, money, and fatherhood or motherhood. They need to feel they're attached, they're part of this family. Unless you come and wake them up in the morning, what about a nice hug to do to a child when they woke up in the morning? Assalamu alaikum, good morning, how are you, son? How are you, tired? You know, you hug them and say, mashallah, you look beautiful today. Oh, you look, mashallah, handsome. All right, you'll have a good day. Look at this, you know, small, nice words which can change their lives. Their acting would be so positive. They'll go out when they're happy. But if you go in there and say, you know, just why do you make them cry? There's no need to do that. So, there is a great responsibility. And Allah and the Prophet said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّ رَاعٍ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ. Every one of you is a guardian, like a shepherd who's after the herd, and everyone who's a guardian is responsible for what they take care of, what they guard. Everyone. And the Prophet said, the women, the father, family members, rulers, they're just in care of their, the ones that Allah has made them responsible for. So obviously, it's a challenge, it's a responsibility, it's a blessing on one hand, and a challenge on the other. The best thing is to learn how to do it. And by the way, alhamdulillah, there's so much of knowledge available to go and look at the internet, take some seminars and workshops in this regard to be a better person, be a better parent. And thirdly, one important aid in this, which is dua. You raise your hands in the night for your children. Do dua in sujood. Do dua for them in between adhan and iqamah. During the time when Allah is answering your dua for them. And Quran is full of dua for children, by the way, in children. رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّةِ رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءَ وَاجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا رَبِّ هَبْ لِي رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ. Something that the eye is happy with you look at it. وَاجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And all these du'as are very important. رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي أَنْ أَشْكُرَ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَى وَالِدَيْهِ وَأَنْ أَعْمَلَ صَلِحًا تَرْضَاهُ وَأَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي. Make my own offspring righteous. وَأَصْلِحْ لِي فِي ذُرِّيَّتِي إِنِّي تُبْتُ إِلَيْكَ وَإِنِّي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. So all of this du'a that is found in the glorious Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet is very important. And it's a weapon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer. And in fact, the dua of the parent is answered if it is for their children. It's one of the ones, one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers and promised to answer is the dua of the parents for their children. Or the wife or astaghfirullah, or against their children. So we have to be careful not to make dua against them. Sometimes if we make dua against them, Allah will respond. May Allah not bless you, may Allah not make you a good, successful person. You're bothering me, you're doing this to me. May Allah curse you. And stop from life. Then happen. Then what? You lost your children. They're not blessed anymore. They are cursed because you made the dua sometimes when you're hungry. So try to control. Control yourself. When you're not happy, say hadakum Allah. Make dua for them to have hidayah and guidance. Don't make dua against them. And even worse is to curse or to make la'am or damning, a'udhu billah, which is going to reach even the seventh generation down all the way. So dua is very, very critical weapon. It can work for you, work against you. Work for you if you do it sincerely for Allah and for the interest of this child. And against you if you do it in the wrong way, just like using a weapon in the wrong way, it can kill. And we've seen cases where dua has made terrible consequences for a person. Because Allah is there. And whatever you say with your tongue is watched by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you brought it upon yourself, as they say. So, make dua for them all the time, even when they make you angry. SubhanAllah, you know, this interaction between husband and wife and children and parents is a fact of life. When Aisha radiallahu anha, she was so much beloved by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes they get into disagreement, like any two couples. And when she would say, for example, Wa Rabbi Muhammad. She would say, Ya Muhammad. He said, Wa Rabbi Muhammad. She swears by the Lord of Muhammad. That means she's not really happy. See? There's a sign there. They didn't transgress even when they're not happy. They didn't transgress. They just express unhappiness in someone. So we can send the same message to our children. We're not happy. Hadakallah. May Allah guide you. May Allah guide you. May Allah forgive you. Or, I remember Sheikh Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz, rahimahullah, you know him. He was a Mufti of Saudi Arabia. And sometimes he answers lots of calls for people asking questions, fatwa, asking for fatwa and so on. Sometimes when they make him angry, he said, Sabbih, Sabbih. Do tasbih. Or istighfar, you know, ask for istighfar. That's how he expresses unhappiness. But he doesn't say anything bad. He said, just only something. Or istighfar. Just make tasbih and make istighfar. So you can do the same thing for your children. Ask them to do something good, but show them that you're not happy. They will learn it. As I said, children are very smart and they know who treats them well, who wants good for them. And we learn. We need to learn how to control ourselves. Be ourselves good examples. I know it's hard. Sometimes some parents don't control themselves. They say, what can I do? What can I do? I'm tempered. I'm this, I'm that. Well, everything has a solution. You're not born to be tempered. You can reduce it. You can work on it. And that could be possible by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi أن يبارك لنا ولكم في أموالنا وأولادنا وأزواجنا وأن يجعلهم قرة أعين لنا جميعا يا الله. Make our children, our families happy and blessed. May He subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all into the straight path. May He help us in this endeavor of His worship until we meet Him when He's so pleased with us. Ameen. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.